Welcome. I'm very excited to be here today. Part of my excitement is driven by the mix of people in the room, because we have faculty, we have students, we have alumni. And part of my excitement is because it's about accounting, and I'm an accounting person. I know it's way more exciting to us, but anyway. It really is an auspicious day for us, because we've been thinking about having a center for professional accounting practices for some time. It's been on our mind, but we hadn't really articulated the vision for the center until recently, under the leadership of Chaim Moses, who is the chair of the accounting department, as well as several faculty who I'll mention in a moment. We really came together and came up with a vision for what this Center for Accounting, professional accounting practices could be. We also have a very special donor, Mr. Ed Strohs, who supported this center and also helped us brainstorm around what the focal points of the center would be. Unfortunately, he's traveling for business. He emailed me late last night saying that he would be unable to be here, but he looks forward to participating in the future. I mentioned that there are several faculty, three in fact, that I want to recognize, who have been working together to roll the center out. The first is David Shackow. The second is Stan Violotis. And finally, Barbara Porso. This team of three has been responsible for developing the vision and for implementing what the center will be. In addition to being extraordinarily popular with their students, Dan, Stan, and Barbara all have great contacts within both industry and in academia. So today really is the beginning of a new accounting department for Fordham. And part of that is an emphasis on research. Just to mention a few, Danielle Green and John Sean, both accounting faculty here, have been doing work on analysts herding in forecasting earnings. And that research has been published in the Contemporary Accounting Research, or CAR, which is a really important journal in our field. Ben Segal has been publishing in the area of non-earnings news interpretation of the news and managerial over-optimism. Again, being published in really high-quality academic journals. We also have faculty that are doing research on private information and patents. For us, this research center is going to serve a bridge between industry and academia. And today's panel is going to be the first example of how we do that. I'd like to now turn it over to my valued colleague, David Shackow, who will introduce our speakers. If you don't know David, he has been here at Fordham since 2014. He's also a professor emeritus from the University of Pennsylvania School of Law. He's a graduate of Harvard College and Harvard Law and NYU Law. And we are delighted that he is the executive director of the Center for Professional Accounting Practices, as he is a true asset to Fordham and to the accounting department. David?
Thank you very much, Donna. It's a pleasure to have you all joining us here today. We have a wonderful panel on a very interesting and timely topic. I'm just going to introduce the panel briefly. Greg Ballantyne is Vice President, Senior Consultant at Charles River Associates. Dr. Ballantyne served as Deputy Assistant Secretary for Tax Analysis in the Office of Tax Policy of the United States Treasury, and also as an Associate Director of Economic Policy at the Office of Management and Budget. Kimberly Classing, Professor Classing, is the Thurman A. Miller and Walter Mintz Professor of Economics at Reed College. Her current research studies the taxation of multinational firms, examining how government decisions and firm behavior interplay in an increasingly global world economy. When I consulted my economics advisors, who would be a good professor to bring in to deal with the BEPS issue that we're going to be discussing today, I was given Professor Clausen's name. When I pointed out she was in Oregon, I didn't know if we could reach her. I asked for another name. Didn't do any good. I got the same name back. So we're really very fortunate she could make it here from Oregon. Madeline Corwin is the KPMG LLP's National Service Line Leader for International Tax, as well as Principal in Charge International Tax Policy for KPMG's Washington National Tax Practice. Madeline served as Deputy Assistant Secretary for International Tax Affairs at the U.S. Treasury Department. And Mitchell Kane is the Gerald L. Wallace Professor of Taxation at NYU School of Law. He was previously on the faculty of the University of Virginia School of Law, has held visiting professorships at the University of Pennsylvania, Columbia University, and Harvard University. Our topic today is the BEPS project dealing with base erosion and profit shifting in the world. Professor Clausing will start off by explaining how it's possible that most of the world's nations could come together to try to some extent, give up on their own sovereignty in order to reach an agreement as to how taxes, how income might be allocated among all the countries of the world in a relatively equitable manner. Madeline Corwin will then give us an overview of the project, what some of the issues were, the technical issues that were involved in this kind of profit shifting, and some of the solutions that the BEPS project has come up with. Dr. Ballantyne and Professor Kane will give examples in some narrow areas in more detail as to the kinds of issues that arose. The panel will, after the presentations, perhaps comment on each other, but also they're prepared on a wildly speculative basis to discuss what the effect of Tuesday's elections might be on this BEPS project and more generally on the international tax situation. They will not necessarily expect you to believe everything they say, because they're not, I think, sure exactly what's going to happen either. So with that introduction, let me turn it over to Professor Clausing.
Thank you, David, and thanks for inviting me to be part of this panel. I'm happy to come here all the way from Oregon, so that was no problem. What we're going to be talking about today, as you know, is this base erosion and profit shifting problem. What my research looks at is the scale of this problem, how we might measure how big the problem is. So I'll try to set the context that way, and also sort of tell you a little bit of background about how we came to have this problem. So if you look at the current system of taxing multinational firms, one thing to be aware of is that all the countries of the world pretty much use a separate accounting system. And that is really at the root of the ability to shift profit across borders, because we're asking each firm, each multinational firm, what income and what expenses they earn in all the countries that they operate. And so they have some discretion really in how they report that. I mean, one thing to think about with respect to a multinational firm is this question: why do we even have multinational firms? Like, if they really could operate at arm's length and have identical outcomes, then they would. So there must be some actual advantage to being multinational above being a bunch of domestic firms operating at arm's length. And once we've recognized that, then it really, in a way, we've already got ourselves a philosophical problem surrounding how to assign the income, because there's going to be extra income associated with being a multinational firm. Where does the extra income go? Plus, there's this sort of the tax incentive, of course, to report the income in the low tax countries. Now, technically, the United States is a worldwide system of tax, and much brouhaha has arisen about the idea that we're separate from all the other countries of the world, or most of the major ones, which use a territorial system. So under a territorial system, you exempt the foreign income from taxation, and under a worldwide system, you still attempt to tax it, but you give them a tax credit for the tax that they paid abroad. Now, I would argue that that distinction between worldwide and territorial is really a false one, in the sense that the U.S. has a quasi-territorial system, or as Jason Furman liked to call it, a stupid territorial system, and I'll explain that in a second. But I would also say that the territorial countries of the world probably tax, in many cases, more foreign income than the United States does, because of, in many instances, like in France and Japan, they have tougher tax-based protections that tax some low-tax country income currently. At any rate, so the U.S. system is worldwide, but we don't tax the foreign income until it's repatriated, which gives firms an incentive to sort of have the income earned and accruing in the low-tax countries. We provide tax credits for foreign taxes paid, but you can also use those tax credits to offset tax that would be due on royalty income under some territorial systems. And we have various provisions and loopholes that allow for the creation of what Ed Kleinbart has termed stateless income, or income that doesn't end up being taxed anywhere. And so basically both the United States and the other countries of the world, multinational firms have this incentive to move income to low tax countries, whether their governments purport to have a claim to tax it or not. That incentive is definitely there. So what are the problems with this system? I would argue that it's not really suited to the global economy and global firms, because we already have this philosophical problem that there's sort of extra income that could be anywhere. And firms are truly integrated across borders. It's really hard to tell where the source of the income is. If you look at the modern firms, it's an even more difficult problem, because if you think about Google or Apple or Amazon or any number of intangible intensive firms, it's not really clear entirely what the source of their profit is. You know, if Apple Computer sells a bunch of computers to Chinese customers, and the computers are made throughout the world, different parts in different places, but designed in California, you know, there's a lot of ambiguity about where that profit is truly generated. Customers generate some profit. Without customers, you wouldn't have the ability to sell your product. The design idea generates some of the profit. But, you know, this ambiguity can be exploited basically to sort of say that it's all in Bermuda, if you want, or Ireland, or wherever you have it. This third problem that I point to here is that I do think the separate accounting system generates a lot of complexity, and we'll talk about the OECD G20 process, and they've basically generated 1,930 pages of recommended guidelines if you add up all the different action items. And I think that that shows you right off the bat that this is a pretty complex issue, and I would argue a waste of talent. If we could have a more simplified system and an easier way to assign the income, then perhaps some of the people who would be accountants and lawyers, no offense to the crowd, could do something more socially useful with their time, or have an easier job, go home earlier. And of course, I've already mentioned this huge incentive to shift income. So these are all problems with the system. So the OECD G20 project, and I should insert G20 every time I say this, because the G20 countries are involved, not just the OECD countries, has many useful aspects. It's a useful example of the international community coming together to solve a problem. They've got these 15 action items, some of which we're going to dig into more deeply today. A lot of useful ideas, including this concept of country-by-country reporting, where these firms tell governments where they're paying taxes so that they know, you know, where the income is being reported. Action 2, I think, is particularly interesting, and we'll be talking more about that later, too. Like I said, there's still some drawbacks. You know, if you're trying to tell, for instance, a developing country how to implement the separate accounting sort of arm's length standard, and you point them to this 1,931 pages of recommended guidelines, it's not entirely clear that every country is going to have the tax administration capacity to really figure out where the income is earned. I would argue that the United States is having an awfully hard time with it ourselves, the poor state of IRS funding isn't that helpful, but, you know, even absent that consideration, I don't think this is particularly easy to administer system. And it does sort of start from the premise that it's not going to do anything fundamental, in the sense there's going to be a lot of action items, a lot of sort of tinkering, but we're not going to challenge this idea of source and separate accounting. Okay, area that I would like to focus on to sort of motivate the rest of our discussion today is whether this is even a problem. And there's actually some controversy about whether this is even a problem. You can find academics and others who will sort of argue that, firms shift a little profit, that's true, but it's not that much money. And, you know, the corporate tax is an inefficient tax anyway, and so if there's less of that, all better. We could have just argued that this, you know, is in a way just a sort of a useful, healthy form of tax competition that's going to, you know, rein in the Leviathan state. I think that if you look at the data, both sort of stylized facts, but also more carefully, that you can find quite a bit of evidence. This is a large problem, which is I'm going to take you through. But I would point out that it's important to rely on the best practices data. And the one thing that the OECD process has generated is this Action 11 item, which is that we need to come up with better measures of this problem so we can see how big it is for the different countries of the world, and we can also see whether we're making any progress in addressing this problem. But if we're looking at sort of a lot of guesswork, we're not necessarily going to know, you know, what the problem is and whether we can solve it. So I think this, the data issue is key here. Some of the stylized facts. There's a lot of news stories throughout the world that have paid attention to multinational companies who have shifted profit abroad, and you'll get sort of a big story every few weeks on this. There's estimates that there are about $2.5 trillion worth of offshore earnings with just U.S. multinational firms alone. If you look at their profits relative to the scale of the places that they're reporting the profits, you get things that are clearly implausible. So GDP is a value-added concept that measures how much economic activity is occurring in a country. So it doesn't really make sense that the affiliates of one multinational base country, like the U.S. affiliates, would earn profit that was equal to 16 times the GDP of Bermuda, say, but yet that's what they report, and 20 times the GDP of the Caymans. So some of that income isn't really being generated in Bermuda or the Caymans. It doesn't really kind of make sense that 10% of your worldwide income would be on an island with 80,000 people. And if you go to Bermuda, which I am thinking of, you know, I just put a research proposal out there. I just want to tour the tax havens of the world. But I happened to Cyprus and some of the other tax havens. If you go and you poke around, there's not a lot of evidence of activity that's generating, you know, 10% of worldwide profits, but there are a few shiny buildings that are probably housing, you know, accountants and mailboxes and things like that. Some evidence indicates that this is large. The Joint Committee on Tax estimates that the tax expenditure associated with deferral is now $80 billion a year. And the IMF has concluded this is a larger problem as a share of GDP for developing countries. Here's just a few facts. These bars show you the share of foreign income that is earned in different countries of the world for U.S. multinational firms. So these are the top nine countries. Of these top nine countries, seven of them, I think I can be the one with nine, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah, seven of the top nine have tax rates that are less than 5% on an effective tax rate basis. The two that don't are the United Kingdom and Canada, two of our closest English-speaking friends, and the other seven all have tax rates that are less than 5%. There's their effective tax rate if you look at those. If you add up these seven countries, their combined population is less than that of California, it's less than that of Spain. But if you add up the profits that are earned in those seven countries, it's about 51 to 55%, depending on which series that you look at. So it seems a little, I mean, this is just another stylized fact. It seems a little odd to say that, okay, we're going to generate 50% of the foreign profits in countries whose combined population is less than that of Spain, right? So there's probably some base erosion and profit shifting going on. How big is the problem? This is a little bit hard to figure out. So what I do in my research is I basically look at countries like, you know, Bermuda and the Netherlands and Luxembourg and ask, how much profit do we think would really be in those countries absent this income shifting incentive, right? And so there's basically a regression analysis that looks at data that controls for other features of these economies that you think would influence their profit rates. And maybe Ireland is just special because of the luck of the Irish, you know. And so you'd want to account for the fact that they might have higher profits due to perhaps a country-specific fixed effect is the statistical term of what we use. We allow Ireland to be special. You control for their GDP and their GDP per capita and the scale of operations there and the like, and then you sort of come up with an estimate of how much profit you think should be there absent this tax avoidance. Now, if there were less profit in Ireland or Bermuda or Luxembourg, it's not all going to come back to the United States. Right? Because these are multinational firms, and they're probably moving profit from all of their operations throughout the world back to, you know, these low-tax countries. And so the second step of the analysis is to sort of guess, you know, absent this income-shifting incentive, not just what the incomes would be in the different countries of the world, But how much comes back to the United States versus others if we're trying to come up with a U.S. revenue estimate. So what I do is basically take a proxy that's based on the scale of their transactions with the home company versus with other foreign affiliates, and I use that share to sort of derive these estimates. And I come up with a magnitude that's about $100 billion a year of revenue loss for the U.S. government. And here's some of the estimates for particular countries, and these are the big seven havens that are causing most of that revenue loss. And so, for instance, if you look at the Bermuda row, $80 billion were reported in Bermuda in 2012, this is their 2012 data. I estimate that there should be $10 billion there. I don't say that the $70 billion difference all comes back to the United States. I say 39% of it would be in the United States, and the other 61% would be in other higher tax countries of the world, higher tax than Bermuda. So that gives you that estimate. Now, this $10 billion, I would argue, is still too high. Remember, Bermuda is just this little island with 80,000 people, but that's what the statistics sort of spit out when you're sort of using this analysis to control for other things that you think might be influencing profit rates. To give you some perspective, in the same year, U.S. affiliates report $13 billion of profit in France and $18 billion in Germany. So you've got Luxembourg with 15 after, again, this adjustment, 96 before. So that gives you some sense of the scale of the problem. I would also point out that if you add up the shares for those seven havens, you get about 82% of all the income shifting is just those seven. And if you add the other countries that have effective tax rates under 15%, that's 98% of all of the income shifting. So when we're thinking about policy solutions to this problem, I would argue that if you lower the corporate tax rate from, say, 35%, which is our purported corporate tax rate, to 20, you're still going to have this incentive, which is all with respect to these really low tax rate countries, right? I mean, I don't want to pay 20 either if I don't have to, right? So just getting it down 15 percentage points isn't going to take that incentive away. What would be more effective, I think, perhaps, is something like a minimum tax, because if you say, okay, regardless of where you earn it, you have to pay currently, you know, 15, 20%, whatever you want to pick that rate to be, then that's going to sort of remove a lot of this activity, which is really occurring with this, with the havens. It's not really about shifting money between, you know, Italy and France. It's about shifting it out of all of the high tax countries toward the havens. This is not just a problem for the United States. So getting to this question of how countries came together, these are my estimates of the revenue loss for some of the other big countries of the world. And you'll see that for the group, it's about 20% relative to their corporate tax revenue. That's my best estimate. But you see all of the countries that have tax rates above 15% are sort of net losers from this profit shifting problem. Now, again, some people say this isn't that big of a deal, so let's take their concerns seriously. One concern says, okay, well, look, here's corporate tax revenue relative to GDP for OECD countries. So that dark, thick line is the OECD average. The dotted line underneath it is the U.S. average. One thing you'll notice about both those lines is they're pretty flat. So you could say, okay, flat lines, not a problem, because, you know, whatever this erosion is that you're so worried about, Kim, look, not a problem, because we have pretty consistent revenues relative to GDP. It's true the U.S. has less than the OECD, but the U.S. also has a big pass-through sector, so that's an excuse for that. But then you have to deal with this fact, which is if you look at corporate profits as a share of GDP, they're increasing dramatically. Now, this is a much longer time scale, but just that the right third of this corresponds to the time period that I showed you on the prior slide. So this is 2000 to 2015 or 13, and this is 1960 to 2015. So if you just focus on this last part, you see that corporate profits as a share of GDP have increased by you know, over 50%, from sort of hovering around 6% to hovering closer to 10%. So if you've got, you know, that dramatic an increase in profits, but flat profit tax revenues, you know, obviously there can still be profit shifting. So that's one of the counters. Another counter is that there are some financial data using this Orbis Amadeus Bureau Van Dyke database that indicates it's not that big of a problem. But one of the problems, if you drill down to those data in the accounting databases, is that often the affiliates that are in low tax countries have a lot of missing fields, including their income. So you can't actually get good data on the very same countries that are driving this problem, relying on those big financial databases. And researchers have used that. You end up with almost no observations from the countries that I just showed you on that list. And so I call this a classic lamppost problem, because there's a story about economists looking for their keys. And you know, you see this economist looking for their keys under the lamppost, and you're like, oh, you're looking for your keys, you lost them here. And they're like, no, I lost them over in those bushes, but this is where the light is. Right? And economists are always tempted where there's good data to go digging around there. And the problem with the financial data is it doesn't have the country detail and the tax havens that you're ever going to find your keys there. Right? I mean, you're looking under the lamppost, but really the problem is off where there aren't data. And Action 11 suggests some big improvements in data collection, including using tax return data and survey data. And what I use in my analysis are survey data, where multinational firms are required to report on those surveys what they're doing. Okay, I'm just going to conclude with a couple of comments on the larger role of the corporate tax, because you know, we could argue also that we don't like the corporate tax, and so therefore, if people are avoiding it, two bads make a good. A bad thing, you avoid a bad thing, that's a good thing. But I would argue that there's some reasons to still support a larger role for the corporate tax in the tax system. And one of them, in the United States at least, is that we don't actually tax a lot of corporate income at the individual level. If you look at the latest research that's come out just in the last year, including a paper by Rosenthal and Austin at the Tax Policy Center, but also a paper I'm working on with Len Berman, you see that about a quarter of U.S. equity income is taxed at the individual level. A lot of it is tax exempt because it's in retirement accounts, it's in endowments, it's in 529 accounts. And the growth of all of that, as well as the growth of foreign holders of U.S. equity, has generated a situation where really only a quarter of U.S. equity income is being taxed at the individual level. So we don't really have a double tax problem for a lot of corporate income. So that leaves the corporate tax as an important role, given that capital income and profits are both increasing. And capital taxation can be efficient with more realistic economic models. It's more progressive than many other types of taxes. And it's a useful part of tax administration, because the corporate form itself can become a tax shelter if the corporate rate falls far below the individual rate. So these are all issues. Finally, politics, say a few words about that. You know, if you ask people, voters, on the left or on the right or in the middle, whether we should tax firms, they all think we should. There's nobody who's like, no, let's cut the corporate taxes and raise my taxes. Now, you could argue as an economist that they're just silly because people pay taxes, not firms. And I agree. Like, we all know that people pay taxes, not firms. I mean, because the firm is... It's either going to be shareholder people, it's going to be worker people, it's going to be customer people. Somebody is paying the tax. It's not just like you can really tax a building or something. Right? You know, so, I mean, I do think that that's an issue. But, you know, if you view the corporate tax as sort of a way of withholding an individual level tax, I mean, it is going to be a pretty progressive tax. A couple lessons for policy as we go forward here in talking about this profit shifting problem. One thing I would point out is that there are decades of thoughtful research in public economics that suggests that real tax responses are much smaller than financial tax responses. So part of what you're seeing in all of these data are the fact that firms can, with the stroke of a pen or a keyboard, you know, move profit across countries. But that doesn't mean that, you know, if you somehow taxed their global income, right, that they would then sort of go home, you know, and take their ball and go into the corner and not make any income, right? Just like you or I, if we were only taxed on the income we earned on Tuesdays and Thursdays, we'd manage to arrange it such that we, you know, earned all of our income on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. That's a financial response, right? But if we're taxed on all the days of the week, right, then we probably will keep working. It's not like we're going to stop working. And a lot of the sort of research suggests that this is a key distinction. And there's three surveys right there that I point you to that will go over that. And so I think one of the root of this matter is the fact that source is a very difficult problem in a modern global economy, to just figure out where the income is because of this flexibility. And political will is a big issue, and we'll be talking more about the post-election reality, but one thing I would point to is it's not entirely clear where our president-elect stands on these issues. It's sort of the emphasis on sort of nationalism and, America First stuff would make you think that some of his early proposals to get rid of deferral might be something that the Trump administration would stand by. But there's also been a lot of very aggressive sort of tax cutting stuff going on. And there's a tension there, right? Because if you want to lower taxes on firms to make them more competitive, right, then that probably means a more eroded tax base than if you're trying to clamp down on offshoring. It probably means a less eroded tax base. So one thing that we can talk about later when we turn to the other panelists and at the end is how they will resolve that tension. But I'll leave it at that.
Thank you very much, Kim.
Projection, they don't look quite as good as on the screen. So I think, Kim did a great job of presenting, I think, some of the outcomes that are troubling to governments in terms of the statistics about results. I thought I would take a step back and talk about why we have international tax rules in the first place and then how we got to the BEPS project. And why the world has come together on it, and I would say actually the world didn't come together. They've been together on international tax policy for a long time, and there's a reason for that. And then just with respect to shifting of profit, there's in the context of the base erosion and profit shifting work, and in the context of concern about the outcomes that you see a disproportionate amount of profit ending up where there's little economic activity. When people talk about profit shifting, they talk about it in a negative way, that it's sort of a deliberate deliberate tax avoidance tool. The fact that we've got companies that are operating across borders, that fact leads to the conclusion that they're going to have incidents of profit in lots of different jurisdictions, and it's also a fact that a lot of countries who are touched by a particular company are going to have an interest in possibly collecting revenue from those. So at some level, profit is going to be shifted or distributed or has to be in multiple jurisdictions if you're going to be a global firm. And because companies in an increasingly global economy are going to have choices about how to establish their operations, there is an element of control in the company's sense as to where they act and therefore where profits may end up. So not all profit shifting, and I would say, is a reality of global global operations. The question is, when does it become harmful from a tax policy perspective to the revenue authorities, and when does it erode bases? What kind of profit shifting erodes domestic tax bases, and what kind of profit shifting is just a natural outcome of operating in a global economy? So, let's start there. Okay. So with that, as a starting point, what I wanted to do is talk at first just about what are the drivers of international tax policy and start really basically in terms of, what's the difference between domestic and international tax. So if you think about the reason we have tax is to generate revenues to pay for the functions of government, and that domestic budgets determine how much revenue a particular country needs. Tax, the domestic tax policy of that country prescribes how you're going to collect that revenue or how you're going to achieve that revenue by setting a tax rate and defining a base, right? Prescribing what is the base that you're going to tax. So, and then of course an administration that makes it effective. So if you say that's your starting point, that's what domestic tax policy is about, I think it's important in terms of understanding the role of international tax policy to understand that when you've got sovereign nations who are setting domestic policies and setting that their base, that those countries each have the ability, the sovereign right, to make that base as wide as they would like. So, that what that means is they could, as a matter of domestic policy, a country could decide to tax its own corporations that are incorporated in its own jurisdiction on their worldwide income without regard to what any other country does or how any other country chooses to tax that corporation, and without regard to providing relief for double taxation. So countries are free to do that with their own tax residents. They are also free to tax inbound activity or countries that are operating in their jurisdiction using incidents of nexus, whatever factor of nexus they'd like to choose. I would sometimes say that France could choose to tax you if you happen to be going to a French restaurant, or if you use in the U.S., if it chose to, it would be very difficult to collect, and it may create interesting incentives. But there's no sort of limit other than their own constitutional rules as to how broad they set the base with respect to activity of their own companies outside of their jurisdiction and activities that are inbound. So the question then becomes, if international tax rules are, in my mind, international tax rules, how we tax our companies operating overseas or how we tax inbound companies are really about limiting what otherwise could be an unlimited taxing right? It's your sort of self-chosen or your self-selecting limitations on tax, and there are reasons for that, and why we choose, for example, not to go worldwide without relief from double taxation or taxing inbound companies on somewhat tangential nexus principles. And I think that's important. And I think there are a number of components. I'm going to get into how do you control the levers of how you tax international in a minute. But collaboration and consensus in the international tax space is very key, because if I'm going to give up taxing rights with respect to my businesses operating overseas or businesses coming in, or limit those taxing rights, I must be doing it for a reason. There must be something that I get out of it as an economy. And that has been the driver. There's really two things that have driven international tax policy from the start, really, from the 1920s when we started down the road, or after 1918 of taxation. One is to make sure that where your companies are operating globally, that there aren't barriers to investment. So countries have an economic interest in encouraging investment and growth, economic growth, and being able to remove barriers to cross-border investment can be a driver of growth. And among the barriers to cross-border investment could be, one of those barriers could be double taxation. So if I go back to my premise that every country has the sovereign right to tax without regard to what other countries are doing, and without relieving double tax, and every country applied the same principle, then if I'm a company operating in multiple jurisdictions and every country chooses to bring the weight of its full domestic tax system or rules on all of my income, you could have the same amount of income being taxed multiple times, and it would make that income disappear eventually, or it could be, have the company go to debt. So that that's a very extreme example, but obviously that what will happen is companies will choose not to go anywhere because they can't afford to be taxed on multiple incidences of income multiple times, or they may set up in a place where that doesn't happen. So that is part of the reason. In every country, if all of our trading partners do this, and the U.S. tax policy today, or even a policy that looks to figure out how can we change the way we allocate income, is cognizant of that. There's an incentive here to give up some taxing rights with respect to global income. And the reason for that is to make sure that you're not basically limiting investment to the point where either your companies aren't growing and taking advantage of globalization, or your countries aren't investing. That said, the other driver, of course, is you don't want your tax base to be eroded. So you don't want to be taken advantage of and make it so that you give up rights in certain cases, but other jurisdictions don't give up rights. So I think just a foundational principle here, or a couple of foundational principles. One is that you've got businesses operating and touching multiple jurisdictions. They are, by definition, going to have incidents of profit in multiple jurisdictions. If everyone taxed them at their full rates, the same income, or if there wasn't some system of allocation or some principal standards or principles that allocated that income, that could be problematic. But if your standards that you do set up, and the global standards are set up, are such that it's possible for income always to shift to places where there's zero taxation and where the economic activity isn't happening, that's also not a particularly good deal for governments. But I wanted to start out with the premise is that there does need to be some sort of collaboration among countries to kind of figure this out. And they do have this common interest in encouraging investment, removing barriers, but also protecting the base, their domestic bases, as they have agreed, you know, as they agreed to collaboratively. So how do they do that? Well, with respect to removing barriers to cross-border investment, you know, over time, a number of principles have arisen, again, through collaboration. The notion that it's important to relieve double tax in certain cases is a fairly common understanding among most jurisdictions. That you know, the U.S. does it through a foreign tax credit, other countries do it through exemption systems or territorial systems. It gets complicated. The U.S. also does it through deferral, but that's a premise, relieving some level of double taxation. Transfer pricing rules are fundamentally about how do I figure out when I have a company that's making profit but has multiple elements of that profit activity, where how do I know how much of the profit is in each jurisdiction? Transfer pricing principles are intended to define that. If you don't have agreement at some level on how you come up with those principles through countries, if one country has one set of principles, another country has another set of principles, you're not gonna get a cohesive allocation. You're not gonna have an agreed allocation. So an agreement on transfer pricing guidelines is important, and that has been around for a long time. How you define tax residence, when is your activity in a particular jurisdiction sufficient for you to be a taxpayer in that country, an agreement, how that happens. And then other ways are through tax treaties that relieve the movement of capital and income across jurisdictions. So those drivers or those levers are the levers that a lot of countries use to manage this notion of how do I make sure that I'm not creating double tax incidents or barriers to investment. But they also care about protecting their base, and they use some similar levers. So CFC rules are a lot about protecting the tax base of a jurisdiction. If I have a subsidiary overseas, you don't want to have the ability to shift profit into that subsidiary and have it escape your domestic tax base if it's not appropriate to do so. Limits on deductions, so earning stripping rules, I can reduce my tax base in one country by making deductible payments out. Limits, you know, withholding taxes absent a treaty, again, are ways to prevent the erosion of tax base. And again, treaties themselves, by putting limits on when you can access the treaty, are ways to protect the tax base. So with those parameters, let's talk a little bit about BEPS. And I'll just say that the BEPS itself wasn't the birth of collaboration and coordination. The OECD has been working on being, at least with respect to a lot of the more developed countries, has been working on sort of being the keeper of international standards that try to meet these two objectives, you know, to deal with base erosion, but also address a collaborative way of allocating income and jurisdiction to tax. Before that, it was the League of Nations. So the OECD has been doing that for a long time. The concerns about the ability to apply the current standards, the agreed standards, in ways that could cause income to be stateless or shift has been around at the OECD for a while. But the fact of the project, sort of the birth of the base erosion and profit shifting project about 3 or 4 years ago now, had a lot to do with kind of a perfect storm of activity. I think in Europe, there was obviously the financial crisis hit the globe. It was particularly pronounced in Europe, where austerity measures were in place, and there were an effort to look for ways to deal with the circumstances and an increase in tax on individuals and consumption taxes. So that led to a significant amount of sort of vocalization and sort of a public outcry around, you know, the fair share, whether companies in fact were paying their fair share, particularly during a time where the crisis, many pointed fingers at corporations for having been, or financial institutions for been the cause of the crisis. So there was a significant amount of public fervor. The notion of how much tax is being paid was becoming a mainstream issue. I think also at the time, you know, it was the policy makers. I mean, so you had large corporations very visible on the street. You had the financial crisis. And at the same time, as this was happening and unfolding, politicians were reacting pretty quickly. They were already under pressure. They needed to make it perceive that the system was fair. And so they were beginning to propose propose solutions that tended to shift from existing international standards, particularly on the transfer pricing side and so forth. So at the OECD, the policymakers, you know, a lot of the folks who were thinking about how do we make this sort of coordinated system hold together, got very, very concerned that what was going to happen was because of the political drive and the political urgency around responding to a public outcry was going to cause an unraveling of what had been at least an agreement that didn't work perfectly, but an agreement that allowed the ability to sort of balance this need to encourage investment, deal with double taxation, but also protect bases, was going to slowly start to unravel with unilateral actions. And so the OECD decided we need to sort of take over because we, as the tax policy folks, have a better understanding of the way these rules work, the intricacies of them. And so rather than allow this to happen, you know, one politician at a time with little understanding of the implications and for both governments and business, let's take the project over and say we're going to address the issue. We recognize that there's a problem, and this goes back to the data and the results. And the problem was, the source of the problem was about the fact that the standards, it wasn't the fact that we collaborated on standards, it's that the standards were no longer fit for purpose. The standards were agreed to at a time, whether they were transfer pricing standards or the treaty rules and the determination of when you have a taxable presence in a jurisdiction, were based on a time when business looked a lot different. We didn't have a digital economy. You couldn't, the system wasn't as global. It was much more bricks and mortars present. So the rules, while they represented collaboration and worked at some level, a lot of business was able to make choices that ended up having countries not collect any tax revenue, income would be stateless, while following the rules, because they didn't really address circumstances where you have a digital company that could be operating in multiple places without physical presence, for example. So that was the reason that the BEPS initiative was launched. It was the context in which it was launched, and then the political drive, it was further supported by the G20 that gave political support to the effort. Just a word on players, because it's important you hear them float around. The OECD obviously has no legal authority to impose any of these policies or standards on jurisdictions. It's a member organization. It was mainly developed countries and had about 34 members. And then with the BEPS project, they expanded it to include also G20 members that were not members of the OECD. But it's a standard-setting body. You know, each government sends a delegate, and they can. Agree on standards, but it is the vehicle for saying, you know, for allowing an agreement on standards for all the reasons that I started with, which is international tax rules only make sense if you've gotten a certain amount of collaboration, collective agreement on the standards you're going to apply. The G20 is obviously has the political authority to endorse, and so the G20 leaders, you know, gave the political backing to what the OECD is doing. The European Commission has been a big player. It's kind of got a little bit of both. It's got both of the political will in Europe, but it also has the ability to impose hard law on its members. But all of this can only happen, all the agreement that happened can only happen if, in fact, the laws are adopted into domestic law. And that is a process that remarkably is happening very quickly, though not necessarily with the goal that we started with, which was to make sure that there was consensus and outcomes that led to a collaborative collaborative effort. I'm having okay. there we go. Okay, so just concepts that come into play as you hear about it. So you've got the concept of tax morality has been thrown out a lot in the public domain as they talked about concerns about companies not paying enough tax and not paying their fair share of tax. And certainly there are, again, are concerns that the system right now doesn't work, and there's certainly companies that don't follow the rules and in fact do things that aren't appropriate in the way that they implement tax rules. That said, in most cases, the concept of tax morality has been broadened to suggest that in some way that a company can apply some moral concept in terms of in determining how much tax it should pay in every jurisdiction. And it's a very difficult concept to apply because, again, I started with the notion that if I'm operating in multiple jurisdictions, and how do I allocate the incidence of my profit or incidence of profit to those jurisdictions, it's difficult to sort of assign a moral choice to that, you know, as between whether I should pay more profit in one jurisdiction versus another that isn't based or informed by actual tax rules and international standards. So clearly if someone is, or a company or an individual is abusing tax and not trying to follow the rules or hiding information and so forth, that you could say is a moral issue. The determination of how to allocate profit across multiple jurisdictions in which you're operating is very difficult to make a moral issue. And in the early reports when they were talking about companies were being called out as to the amount of tax they paid in one jurisdiction, you know, a couple of companies had volunteered to pay more tax in a single jurisdiction in a way that made no sense because, you know, you can't just volunteer to increase your tax payment. It has to be connected to some sort of reality of what the rules are and what you're actually doing. So that comes into play. Transparency has been relevant to both the public debate and what the OECD was doing. Transparency is this notion of somehow if we knew more about the data and the information of companies, we would be able to better determine whether they're actually cheating or not cheating. So there is the sense that companies are reporting income in multiple jurisdictions, but in each jurisdiction they tell, you know, in one jurisdiction they tell one story, in another jurisdiction they tell the other story to justify the profit. The transparency effort was to say, well, let's hear, you know, you have to, all the pieces of the story have to add up to a whole, and the only way to do that is if there's a single report that everybody's aware of. So with that, the OECD initiative then was focused not so much on tax morality and bad behavior of companies. The BEPS initiative was focused on transparency. It was focused on what is it about the standards that we agree to as members of the global community that don't work anymore and cause the results that we're seeing in the data where there's a disproportionate amount of profit in low tax jurisdictions. And then how can we tweak those rules and standards, change them in a way that would address the problem, you know, and replace the original agreement that countries are going in, willing to give up tax jurisdiction in certain cases, taxing rights in certain cases, based on certain assumptions. If those assumptions don't hold anymore, let's look at it again. And then stateless income obviously was an important aspect of this because, again, if you start with the notion that international tax rules and standards are about giving up taxing rights that you might otherwise have or are free to have as a sovereign country, you might not give those rights up if the result is the income isn't taxed anywhere. You might want a different rule, but you still need some method of allocating the income. So the action plan was focused, the BEPS action plan was focused basically on three areas. The first was the structural concerns. It was the concerns about whether or not the actual structure, the international tax rules and standards, the structure of them made sense in the modern economy. And so it had one action item just on the digital economy to study that, but also just looking at whether the problem is at CFC rules. If countries had better CFC rules, would we have this disproportionate shifting problem? Do we need to limit deductions? What is it, our treaties that are the problem, right? Do treaties allow, treaties basically, again, relieve tax to avoid double taxation? Do they go too far? Is it that companies are taking advantage of mismatches between the tax laws of jurisdictions so that they're arbitraging in ways that allow them to shift? And then is the standard for determining when your activity in a jurisdiction is sufficient to allow another country to tax it which is referred to as the PP standard, when do you have a permanent establishment, is that standard inappropriate and too narrow in light of the way that business is done today? So those were the structural concerns, and that, and they, the OECD spent a lot of time, and the many, many pages that Kim referred to were, in fact, about trying to go through what changes ought to be made to those standards. Transfer pricing was another significant aspect of the conversation, and a lot of the discussion was, do the standards at the OECD that countries have been following to apply concepts of how do I allocate profit between related parties, related entities, are they not sufficiently capturing where profit is generated, you know, where value is created? And so they've made tweaks to the transfer pricing rules to try to, you know, align profit with value creation, allocate risk, and deal with intangibles where there's, where a lot of the shifting happens, because those are very mobile concepts. It's not clear that they got that right, and I know we're gonna, Greg, you're gonna be talking about some of the issues with that and whether or not it complicates you know, what they ended up doing, sort of missed the mark. Transparency was another, as I mentioned before, significant. It's about exchanging tax rulings, it's about providing the big picture of every company so that every jurisdiction in which a company is operating gets to see all the data. And then they had a number of process methodology points, one on data collection. One of the things when I was there was a recognition that most of the data that was available to the OECD was US data. And that's partly because the US has a number of researchers that do really good work, but also are the data available in the government. But there was a fairly sparse amount of data about non-US multinationals. So that was part of the Action 11 item to evaluate the issue. And then dispute resolution was an important aspect of this as well. So how successful were they? Well, it's amazing, actually, how much they were able to achieve in a very short period of time. They had consensus on 15 items, but I would say the areas where they've gotten traction so that there is direct impact on companies and changes in countries are in the area of transparency. You have more than 50 countries now that have adopted the transparency recommendations of the OECD. So companies now are required to complete a report that provides information about their companies in every jurisdiction in which they're operating, including income, profit, number of employees, a lot of data. There's some question as to how that document is going to be used. It's supposed to be used for risk assessment. There's concerns that it will be used in other ways, but it's, again, a very significant development that got in place very quickly, and reports are due in 2016, so you'll have governments exchanging those reports with each other. They also require the disclosure of rulings, tax rulings that you receive from particular governments around your income. They have modified the transfer pricing guidelines in ways that, again, you know, I know we're going to get into that, so I'm not going to talk too much about it, but it's interesting in that most countries have an automatic adoption of OECD guidelines. So if the guidelines are adopted in the OECD, they get picked up automatically and are applied in their application of law. On the PEs, the standard for taxable presence, they've expanded the circumstances in which the activity of one of your employees or of your subsidiary can cause you, the principal company, to have a taxable presence in the jurisdiction. That will lead to more taxable PEs. Hybrids, the sort of this arbitrage between, you know, the treatment of entities or the treatment of instruments, debt and equity, have been at least recommended to be neutralized, and they have some mechanisms to do that that wholly depend on cooperation between jurisdictions to make it happen. Treaty abuse, they put in a number into the OECD model that becomes the base for bilateral treaties, a lot of bilateral treaties, a number of provisions that are intended to prevent base erosion, profit shifting, but also to limit the ability to use treaties to get a better rate or move profits from one jurisdiction to another. That is about to be implemented through a multilateral instrument that we're expecting to be published at the end of this month and ratified. The effect of that single document being ratified by member countries would be to amend up to 2,000 treaties at this point, if it actually goes through. And then the improvement of dispute resolution. This just is a visual of how many countries have adopted the reporting, just to give you a sense, the transfer pricing documentation, and then the multilateral instrument that I was talking about, how many countries have signed up at least to be part of the conversation and collaborate. They've also recognized that they need to expand the number of countries that are participate in this process. And so it started out at the OECD, I think it was, 40 new countries have now been added from the original 46. So you can see quickly here, these were the original BEPS participants, a lot of developed countries, it was basically the OECD and G20 countries, and then now they've expanded the inclusive frameworks. It's a lot of the developing countries are now participating in the BEPS project, both on implementation and standards and monitoring of outcomes. So, does that mean now we've got more certainty because and the standards are updated and everybody's acting unilaterally? Well, unfortunately, the political pressure associated with BEPS was proved much stronger than what even what the OECD could do through collaboration. So while there's been some consensus around around the project, there's also been a lot of unilateral action. We saw, you know, on a number of the items at the that I mentioned, the PE standard, for example, we've had the UK, Australia, and others pass domestic law that effectively abandoned the standard that was agreed to by all the countries around the table. And so it creates uncertainty and that balance of, wait a minute, we've agreed about on the principles as to when you tax and when you relieve double tax. It's really undermined that collaboration at some level. In addition, the Commission, the European Commission, has been very, very active in this space. They've also always been concerned about tax avoidance. They've quickly embraced what the OECD has done in terms of the transparency initiatives, but in every case, like, gone a little bit farther. So the country-by-country reporting, the Commission is now proposing for that to be a public document as opposed to one that's exchanged between governments. They've also adopted this anti-avoidance directive, which is law for all of the member countries. It includes in it a lot of the BEPS provisions. It adopts basically as the OECD had them. The BEPS provisions, the ones in magenta, are pretty much the same as the OECD, but then it adds on an additional anti-abuse rule and exit tax. And now they are also proposing two things which are of interest. I may be going to some of the concerns and the issues that Kim, you were raising. One is to propose a common tax base for all EU member countries. So sovereign, you know, again, a little eroding the concept of sovereignty within the EU. They'll continue to allow multiple tax rates, but the belief is that somehow this shifting and base erosion concerns would be more limited, at least within the EU, if you had a single tax base, and if that everybody agreed to across all members. It just came out, they're proposing as two steps. The first would be to agree on a common tax base, and then the second step would be to agree on a common consolidated tax base, so you basically get rid of separateness of the separate company concept and so forth as a way to get rid of even the transfer pricing concerns. One of the things that is of concern about what the EU is doing is the transfer pricing principles, so the arm's length standard, that is the basis for a global agreement at the OECD and has been adopted by most economies, or most certainly most of our trading partners and other economies. They are applying, they will, in this common tax base, will adopt the same language for the arm's length concept for transfer pricing, but have indicated that they are planning to have their own interpretation of it. So again, eroding the notion of, you know, do we have an agreed way to allocate income or not, and at what point is there an incentive to do something different. So on balance, where are we? I mean, I think the goal, and for many, many years, countries thought it was in their best interest to coordinate and collaborate on international tax principles. You need some system. There's a lot of debate as to what the right system is, and maybe going to some sort of formulary apportionment would be simpler, though it's not simple, and there would be a lot of debate as to what are the factors of allocation, how do you get multiple sovereigns to agree on what those factors should be, and who are the winners and losers. So there's complexity associated with that as well, but the fact and the need for some coordination to make it work, I think, is a fairly accepted principle. Where we are today on that is probably weighing more towards uncertainty and unilateral action than we are towards collaboration, notwithstanding the BEPS initiative and the expansion of the inclusive framework. So that does present some challenges.
Thank you very much, Manuel. That was a lot of ground to cover.
Thank David very much for this kind invitation to come up to Fordham. The dean just left, I was going to say. Oh, there's the dean. There's the dean. The dean loves a diverse audience. She started off by saying that. The presenter greatly fears a diverse audience. Some of you may not have heard of BEPS until about 55 minutes ago, and some of you may be on, as Manel and I probably are, on our 47th BEPS conference or panel. So that presents certain challenges, especially because my task on this panel is to now try to go down into a little more detail. So Kim and Manel have given you a great overview, I think, both from the macroeconomic side and from the legal institutional side. And what I want to do is look at two of these particular so-called action items on what are called hybridity and CFCs, control of foreign corporations. And so that's going to require some technical detail. But I want, for those who aren't familiar with the technical law and are encountering this for the first time and might not follow all of it, not to lose sight of the big picture, which is I'm thinking about the basic same question Manal was dealing with, which is, to what extent does it make sense to coordinate or not in this framework? And in particular, I'm going to be looking at that from a US perspective on these two items. And my bottom line conclusion is that coordination is problematic in these two areas. So that's where we're going to get to. Let me try to start off by bridging from Manal's discussion. So she very nicely gave you the almost 100-year history of where international tax coordination is, beginning from the early 1920s in the League of Nations. And for sure, we need coordinating principles. So let's take a thought example, a counterexample, counterfactual. Let's say you had the US, and let's say you had the US doppelganger. So let's annoyingly convert the European Union into a doppelganger of the US, by which I mean, say that they had the identical legal system to us. Okay, so the same corporate law, same tax law, same income distribution, identical, right? Identical in every way. In such a world, we would still need coordinating principles between these two jurisdictions. So for example, if I'm a US company and have capital, which I've raised from US shareholders, and I want to use that capital to build a factory in my doppelganger US jurisdiction, it's going to make stuff and sell stuff in that jurisdiction, we have some income, we're going to want some rules that prevent us from saying, my U.S. gets to tax all the profit because we own the capital, and that doppelganger U.S. gets to tax all the profit because the factory's there. We want a coordinating rule to split the base. And in some sort of simplified way, you can think about the first level of coordination as about getting at that. All right, now back to the world of reality. Of course, we don't have a doppelganger jurisdiction. We have, right, 100 plus, almost 200 other jurisdictions with which we trade, each one of them, right, with their own legal institutional dynamic, different ways of thinking about defining financial instruments, different ways of implementing a corporate tax, different views about the size of the public sector, and we still need to coordinate. So now we still have that baseline principle of splitting the base, but in some ways, part of that, so the part I'm gonna focus on, and the part I think is most problematic to get to the place where we say, oh yes, we should have happy coordination here, are gonna be the ones that push towards saying jurisdictions should be coordinating, thinking the same way about some of these more technical rules that we've historically thought about as part of the sovereign interest determinant. So again, I'm gonna go in a little deep now, but let's not lose sight of the big picture. This is a fascinating one. We are battling in a framework where for sure coordination makes sense, But it's going to the heart of what jurisdictions care about in retaining their sovereignty and defining the scope and form of their tax system. Okay, so the now slide gave you a sense of the range of some places where even within BEPS, coordination makes a lot of sense, like information is one of those. So whatever your actual laws look like, you need information to apply them. What I'm going to look at are the ones that talk more in terms of best practices. And the OECD understood from the outset that when it's getting to the level of substantive internal domestic law, they weren't going to be able to write some things and say, hey, everyone's law should look like this. Okay? Everyone would reject that. So what they had to do was take an approach instead and said, well, let's talk about best practices. Let's talk about almost a menu of options. And within that menu, everyone should be vaguely consistent with this. Just a quick aside before I go into the details. Linguistically, even, this is complicated because I'll observe BEPS and the 47 around here conferences we've had, right? I mean, how many times do you think you've uttered the word BEPS in the last 3 years? Let's remember, okay, the words base erosion and profit shifting, okay, those have existed for a while, but none of us had used the word BEPS before 3 years ago, okay? This is politically ingenious on the part of the OECD. They've taken a group of concepts which in many ways are disparate. There's a lot of nuance, right? A lot of differentiation, and we've smashed it into this umbrella thing. We're gonna call it BEPS. It has an air of badness. We need to work against it. And it really is, I will use the word, an ingenious political move compared to their move 20 years ago, 1997-1998, when they went after some of the same phenomena under the guise of so-called harmful tax competition, made some progress, and then largely gutted by conservative elements in the U.S. and said, hey, tax competition's good, right? Restrain the size of the sovereign, we like that. So this is in a sense a labeling exercise, but we should remember it's disparate. What's under this umbrella is quite disparate. And let's also not forget the lesson of Manel's from the institutional standpoint. This is not binding public international law, not even close, even though in some BEPS fora, I've been to conferences where the stated topic is your jurisdiction BEPS compliant? I just think that's the wrong language, right? It doesn't even make sense to talk about compliance with this thing that isn't binding public international law. Okay, so that's all we're doing. Now let's try to get in a little more detail. So I'm going to talk about Action 3 first, and then Action 2. So Action 3 is about CFCs, so that's a new term, controlled foreign corporations. We're talking about instances where, from the U.S. side, a U.S. subsidiary and a foreign company that the U.S. owns. And the basic issue is, to what extent is the U.S. going to tax the profits of that foreign subsidiary currently? Very roughly, criminal oversimplification. We've historically taken the approach if it's active, we're not going to tax it now, we'll tax it when we pay dividends back. If it's passive, we'll tax it currently. Okay, so the OECD in Action 3 announces some building blocks. Okay, jurisdictions should have CFC rules, they prevent base erosion and profit shifting, and they should look kind of like this. From the US standpoint, it's a discordant exercise to read the Action 3 final report. Because 95% of it is cribbed from us. So the US, I don't know if we should be proud of that or not, probably would not be proud, but we invented CFC rules in the early 1960s. They've been adopted by many jurisdictions since. The adoption has very often followed our approaches in many ways. So I imagine if you were stuck with the tax of legislative draftsmanship in another jurisdiction, and you were told, hey, we need some CFC rules, at least if you go far back enough in time, what you would have done is you would have started off, okay, I'm going to read the Internal Revenue Code and see what the U.S. did. So there's a lot of borrowing from what the U.S. initially did, and so too in this action item report. So I'm not going to bore you with the details, but I just went through it and counted, and at least 10 of the items just are pulled straight out of our domestic law. So these are, so you can remember, what is this about? So these are things like, how do I define what a CFC is? How should I look to thresholds of ownership? How should I figure out which income gets included currently and not? So those are the sort of things where we see broad overlap with the way the US does it. But, and here comes the discordant aspect, there's one giant exception. Which deals with the issue of what I'm going to call foreign-to-foreign stripping. And here it's not, oh, let's look at all the good work the U.S. has done in CFC rules. This is, I won't even say tacit, I mean, for anyone who knows the institutional history, it's right out there. This is basically the European countries and the U.S. coming head to head over something we disagree completely about. And the final report essentially says CFC rules should counter so-called foreign stripping, and the U.S. has a different view of this. So let me try to explain what that's getting at with the little diagram on the right side, which many of you will have heard because it's prominent enough to have made the New York Times coverage. It's at the root of the current dispute between the European Commission, which will now be litigated, and Apple on the structure, which is typically called the double Irish. Okay, so let me just quickly explain what's going on with the double Irish. There are three key elements to this. So we've got a US parent company, it's gonna move IP offshore to some foreign company. So Greg's gonna talk about this. So how do you do that? That's generally through a process called cost sharing. The relevance is the US company is gonna take the position that the IP is owned, at least in part, by some foreign entity, and when the ownership is foreign, that allows the foreign entity to earn income off that IP currently without paying US tax burden. Okay, so that's key step one. US firms like Apple, they've created historically massively valuable IP. They want to exploit it around the world, and they want to do so in a way that those profits aren't going to be taxed currently. Step number one is you got to move at least some of the value of the IP outside the US, or the strategy's never going to work. Okay, so step number two is we've got a royalty flow between these two Irish entities. We've got some triangles and slashes going on, and that's key to the structure. So on the first level Irish company, so that's the Irish IP holding company, and that's where the IP has been transferred to through a cost-sharing arrangement, and the slashed line, the diagonal line, represents the following fact as a matter of law, which is that Ireland does not see this as an Irish company, at least historically. They've recently changed the law, but under the historical approach when these structures were put in place, Ireland would say, all right, you're incorporated in Ireland, but you're not managed in Ireland, so we don't see an Irish company. The US did see an Irish company based on the place of incorporation. All right, so the royalty flowing up from a subsidiary Irish company called that the operating company, and the triangle there refers to the so-called hybridity of this entity. Which reflects the fact that Ireland views this as a corporate entity and the US is viewing it as a sort of flow through a partnership, that is, it doesn't have a tax personality itself. All right, so what's going on there? Why are these pieces put in place? So the key aspect of this is that royalty flowing up from the operating company to the holding company is gonna make a deduction for Irish purposes. Okay, that's gonna reduce the Irish tax base. But on the income side, Ireland doesn't see it as being received by an Irish company. So Ireland says, oh, we're not gonna tax that royalty when received by the IP holding company. All right, now the US part of this. Okay, so CFC rules could take that benefit away. Okay, so a CFC rule might say, oh, wait a second, the Irish IP holding company is a controlled foreign corporation of the US, and when it receives royalties, if it offends our CFC regime, we'll include it currently in the US. But that doesn't work, and this structure doesn't work for two reasons. The one we'll focus on is the triangle. Okay, so the fact that that is a flow through for US purposes means the US doesn't see the royalty payment at all. Okay, it says, right, well, it's like paying anything from a branch to a subsidiary, or moving money from one pocket to another. It's just all internal to one organization. It doesn't have tax relevance. So it couldn't possibly trigger our CFC rules. We have other technical rules that might apply here, but I'm gonna bracket those in the nature of time. All right, now, let me get the third flow, and then I'll try to get the big picture of why the European countries find this offensive. So what I have on the bottom, the third flow of royalties, I should put royalties in scare quotes. So what's going on here, it's not technically a royalty payment. What is more often done here is the Irish operating company is gonna sell tangible goods into the market. I put royalties up there because the value has an embedded intangible return. So the reason Apple can sell iPhones at a high cost, iPads at a high cost, is that it has all this valuable IP in it. They're not technically licensing the stuff, they're just selling it. And the point there is that when that money flows out of the jurisdiction of consumption, so in this context, often EU member countries, they're not going to tax it. Of course, Ireland sees it coming into income at the level of the Irish operating company, but then they're going to see that big offsetting deduction that we saw in step two. Now, they're not going to exactly offset. They're going to need a little bit of profit in Ireland. But the bulk of the profit is going to flow out of Ireland into some haven, which is going to so it's not taxed in the EU country of consumption. It's not taxed in Ireland. It's not taxed in the US currently. Voila, that's how Apple plans into a very low effective rate on its foreign income. All right, so now what's the big picture? The big picture is the European Union looks at this and says, well, that's a weird thing, the square with the triangle in it. Like, so one country says corporation, the other country says partnership. But it's not just weird, it's outright offensive, because the reason it happens is that the US has a rule, which we call check the box, which says you get to choose, it's elective. How do we know if it's a corporation or partnership? Check. I want to treat it as a flow through. So the Europeans see that, and they say, hey, wait a second. This should be picked up by the US CFC rules, right? This is foreign to foreign stripping, okay? Payment from one foreign country to another, or company to another. If the US had reasonably functioning CFC rules, didn't engage in this crazy fiction of saying you get to choose whether it's a flow through or not, then the CFC rules would come in and stop this, and because the US is maintaining such lax CFC rules, we're sort of facilitating this kind of foreign stripping. We should clean up our act, and that's one aspect of this final report, which says we should do that. So again, I shouldn't really go into the technicalities. It's labeled a modified hybrid mismatch, a lot of jargon. Basically just says if you have this kind of hybridity, like an entity hybridity, and the CFC rule would have otherwise applied. If it hadn't been hybrid, then you should include it. That would be the basic outcome. So the US response to date has been, sorry, forget you, but I'm not gonna change my CFC rules, and we're not gonna change our elective entity classification rules. We're just not gonna go along with this. All right, so I'm gonna try to evaluate that. And remember, let's step back to my big point, which is I personally, I marvel at what OECD put out in the 2-year time frame, but I don't think the case has been made for coordination here. And so I'm going to give you a little more detail to give you a sense of some of these fault lines where I think the run to coordination doesn't make sense. Okay, first point is that CFC rules is a new topic for OECD. I mean, they acknowledge this. So historically, this was not within the ambit of what the OECD did. What they historically did was more of what Manal started with, right? We had a model treaty, and it's about coordination between taxing on residence or ownership and source, and coordination makes perfect sense there. There are elements of coordination that make sense there. So we need rules, for example, of residence tie-breaking. So if you're gonna have a system that coordinates tax on source and residence, we need to each be saying who's resident in the same way. And those sorts of coordination make perfect sense. This is very different. This is really about how is a jurisdiction gonna tax the foreign earned income of its companies. And it's not obvious, to me at least, why one needs coordination there, and why it isn't flatly inconsistent with the way we've always thought, and that was part of the sovereign prerogative to figure out. All right, other reasons, I'm gonna skip over. I don't wanna strip Grant Ball's time, so I'm gonna skip some of the detail here, and let me get to the bottom line. So I have some other reasons why I'm skeptical of it, but let's look at the bottom line on what I think is going on with CFCs, and to make a political observation is the following. So the US is currently living with a, I think, very flawed international tax system. That's not a controversial statement. You won't get many people to come forward and say, oh, the current system's great. So one problem with the current system that most people would agree with is our statutory rate is too high. Okay, so at 35% of the corporate rate, we're leading basically the OECD on the statutory rate. So what happens if you try to tax foreign income at this very high rate, higher rate than other people are taxing it? It gives incentives for U.S. firms to not be U.S. firms anymore. So that's the so-called inversion phenomenon when U.S. companies try to escape, or it gives incentives to not incorporate in the U.S. In the first place. So the way I read the current dynamic is we understand this. We understand our statutory rate is too high, but we make the effective rate much lower than that. One way we've made the effective rate much lower than that is really by kind of knowingly eroding the force of our CFC rules over time. So there are technical things we could do overnight, they're not complicated, that would have the effect of bringing more income into the base. I think we doubt that that's a good policy given the level of the back around statutory rate. So it's sort of knowing self-help reduction in the statutory rate to a lower effective rate to make it more in line with what's happening in the rest of the world. Now, as long as that's the case, if someone comes and tells the US, hey, you need to bolster your CFC rules, there's going to be opposition to that because it's going to get the effective rate to a place that really is too high, and we understand that. Now, conversely, if we change the statute, if the statutory rate comes down, then it could very well flip, right? Then we could say, yes, we are fans of strong CFC rules because we like the statutory rate to the effective rate, and we want you to be taxed on it currently because we know there are these horrible lockout problems if you don't do that. And that's what I would expect us to see. And that's kind of consistent with the way that even the Obama administration, which does want to lower the rate and have a sort of current minimum tax, has favored some move to stronger CFC rules as well, and that fits. And so that's a way, and Dave said we're not going to be good prognosticators, and I'm not, but I can say this, I think there's a logic to it, that as long as there's this gap between the effective rate and statutory rate that we like, we're going to take a certain approach logically with weaker CFC rules. And if it changes, if the statutory rate is where we really want it to be, then I think the approach to CFC rules may differ. And that, I think, is a nice, it's a complicated story. It gives you a sense of the nuance. You can't say on or off coordination good. And you can't even say for a single country on or off, yes, coordination good. It's going to look different depending on the background, context, and the stakes are. All right, I've got my eye on the clock. I don't want to drag all this time, and I know we all like to have a little time for discussion. So I would give you a similar story on hybridity if I had the time, but I don't, so I won't talk about it. And so I want to give you a final thing. No, I already gave you a good picture. So I'll talk more about the changed political environment.
A particular kind of deal in the way that a U.S. multinational corporation shifts its profits to a tax haven. Then I'm going to talk about what the OECD proposes to do about that deal, how they want to attack it. And then I'm going to talk about why their attack is wrong and it's going to make things worse. The deal involves what's called R&D cost sharing. Let's imagine XYZ mega corporation, high-tech U.S. corporation. For years, it's been highly successful. I'm not going to use any names of real companies, but you've heard some already. For years, it's been very, very successful. It has a wonderful R&D program. And its foreign affiliates that are making sales use the technology that is developed in the U.S. All the technology is developed in the U.S. The U.S. spends all the money on the R&D. The foreign affiliates get these advanced products that they can sell at high prices, and they have to pay back to the U.S. for the value they receive in terms of that technology. I'm going to use low numbers here as a simple example. Let's say the foreign affiliates pay a 5% royalty back to the U.S., okay? Now, those royalties are often controversial. They're hard to figure out whether it should be 5%, 6%, 50%, whatever. And it causes a lot of trouble with the IRS. But let's say that they've gotten an agreement with the IRS, by and large, that it's 5%. Let's also say that they spend about 3% of their sales on R&D. Again, I'm using low numbers, but it's just illustrative. So they've got a 5% royalty coming in, and then they're spending 3% of total sales, worldwide sales, on R&D. That's the situation when suddenly the tax advisors come in and say, hey, have we got an idea for you? Let's stop this 5% royalty stuff. Let's just have the foreign CFCs pay their share of the R&D. That's R&D cost share. So let's go from a 5% payment coming into the US, which is all taxable in the US, and let's just have them send in 3%, their share of the R&D. To make things simple, let's just imagine that the foreign sales are about equal to half of the worldwide sales. So the foreign affiliates pay in 3% instead of 5%.